Okay, good morning, everyone. I'm Kristen Glorioso. I'm founder and executive director of Longevity Global. We are a curated community of experts in the longevity field. And today we're going to have three companies pitching. So I'm going to turn it over to our first company, to Silvia.
Thank you. Thank you, Christine. Let me share here. Hopefully my Wi-Fi, you can hear me well.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. There you go. Can you see the screen? Perfect. Thank you. So my name is Silvia Veronese. I am the CEO of GTCardio. What do we do at GTCardio? We develop biosensing technologies to help people monitor and understand their cardiovascular system, the health of their heart, arteries, the entire vascular system in the body, and ultimately of the brain as well. We are headquartered in California. We were incorporated a year and a half ago, but we leverage 7+ years of research and development in this field with affiliation with Stanford. So what's the problem we're solving? I don't think I need to spend a lot of time by saying that cardiovascular diseases are the number one cause of death in the world, both in the developed and countries in development. One person dies of cardiovascular diseases every 33 seconds, as compared to people that die of cancer every 2 minutes. But the interesting thing is that the expenditure in cardiovascular health is approximately double of what we spend in cancer and cancer research. Why? Because because the way we believe, because it's the way prevention is done, there is a great need for preventative care. For example, blood pressure is a key indicator. 30% of people have high blood pressure. 60% of us don't know that they have high blood pressure. Why? Because they go to the doctor, they measure blood pressure once a year, once every few months. And the reality is that blood pressure changes very, very rapidly with sub-second granularity. So if you look at this chart, it's very representative. It's from from an article that appeared in Nature Review. We all know that blood pressure goes up and down seasonally, lower in summer, higher in winter. Not that many people understand that blood pressure also changes. One of the, we of course know that changes happen when we are under stress, when we are, we're having an argument, we're preparing for a presentation, when we're running. But one of the things that is a key is that blood pressure rise quite severely at night, especially in the early hours of the morning. And that's one of the key things that GTCardio is doing, understanding how this rising pressure happens. So sleep is one of the key determinants for health, as you all know. So we have a product today which is available, which addresses multiple markets, multiple users. We have a cuffless, external, calibration-free way to measure blood pressure. What does that mean? Cuffless is if you recall what the doctor does when you measure blood pressure, it applies to your arm a cuff that inflates. So we do it in another way. We do it through optical sensors that can be placed in different parts of the body. For the clinician, we offer full 24/7 data that they can extract. They can read, from reports to the raw data. For the insurance, we help insurance promote compliance with drug therapy, titration, which is understanding dosage and adapting dosage to the need of the patient. And for the providers, for the hospital, we offer a platform, a SaaS platform. So just briefly, these are some of the keys differentiators. We are non-invasive. We do it every second, every sub-second. We do not need external calibration. A lot of the devices that are out there in the market now will require you to go calibrate externally with a different tool. We don't. Here you see a snapshot of the product. We do, of course, I've been talking about blood pressure, but reality is that we capture a number of hemodynamic parameters, vascular resistance, cardiac output, which is effectively the amount of blood that is pumped by the heart, stroke volume, it's a measure of work, output, and performance. You see graphs here that depicts the trends, but if you double click, you can see the micro spikes that are really the one responsible for problems like plaque detachment. That's where we focus. That's where our focus is. In our roadmap, we have the development, which we already started, of a smart patch. So the solution you saw in the previous slide, I am wearing it. It comes in the form of a ring here, and then I have I was measuring my blood pressure this morning. This is actually a patch which could be placed in different parts of the bodies, including the earlobe, forehead in certain clinical cases, much less invasive. It comes in two parts, a disposable part and a reusable part. Think of these as very similar to the glucose monitoring devices that you see today in the market, like the Dexcom device. The part of our roadmap, which is also we're hoping to start full development in the next few months, is the extension and the inclusion of multiple sensors that would allow us to do better diagnostics. Today we have optical sensors. Tomorrow we're talking with partners, MIT, for the ultrasounds, potentially ECGs, and then as well as temperature sensors. Those give us a better and more complete view of potential diseases, vascular diseases, especially if we focus on metabolic syndrome. What is metabolic syndrome? Is something that, first of all, affects 30% of the people. It's a combination of high blood pressure, high cholesterol, high BMI, and high blood sugar. Lots of people, unfortunately, especially in the United States, are affected by that. Kind of a technical slide here. For those of you who are engineer, you can probably picture this is an IoT architecture. The key takeaways that we have three different deployment models. We can sell the sensor with the application, like the one I just showed you in the video. We can sell the software only, the SDK, which can be integrated in third-party devices. And we can also offer a fully managed service where our data, the data we collect, is transferred into our cloud and then pushed to the provider cloud think of a hospital or a research institution or an insurance, an HMO that does that needs to get the data for reporting, compliance, notification, remote monitoring. One of the big markets for us is clearly the telemedicine remote monitoring. Over the year, we have established a number of partnerships with manufacturers, different device manufacturers that you see listed below. They have invested in our company. Analog Device was the first one to develop the first device with us. Our primary market is people in need. What does that mean? People that are at risk, pre-hypertensive and hypertensive. Of course, we do also serve the wellness or people that just care about their health, but we believe our primary market today is people that that are recovery from surgeries, that are in assisted care, that are outpatient, and so on. We're targeting mid-size companies. We work either directly with them or through medical distributors. So we have a number of customers that we hope to close in 2000 and second half of this year. In terms of the business model, is pure recurring revenue based on a device cost plus a monthly recurring fee. For long-term care, what does that mean? People that are using our system all the time, if you look at people that are hypertensive, 120 million in the United States. If we capture just a portion of the market with a device cost of approximately $300, which is what the market is, selling for today, and a monthly cost of $10, we have a healthy revenue target of $5 billion. Of course, not easy to get, but that's a target revenue. For short-term care, short-term is essentially people that would wear the system, the device, for a limited period of time because maybe they are in rehabilitation, few weeks, few months. The monthly subscription goes up a little bit. Insurance codes kick in for reimbursement for the device, and we also have a target revenue of $500 million, assuming a 10% attach rate. I'm almost done here, leadership team. Hugh Baron, doctor, cardiologist from Stanford. Myself, Dr. Ron John Nag, he's the president of R42. He's also a Stanford fellow. We also have a business development person with lots of experience in medical system coming on board. This is our advisory advisory board and fellows, and I believe this is my last slide. So what are we looking for? We're looking for investment, and I'm also looking to build and expand the team. And of course, advisors.
Great.
That's all for me.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. Do you want to say, are you guys raising, what stage are you raising at? Do you want to give an ask?
Sure. Let me then go to the next slide. Yeah, the slide with the dollar sign. So we're raising $2 million. The goal of how we're going to spend these $2 million is to finish product development, really focus on the patch. Release a new version, hire a team. As I said, the company did exist originally as a Hong Kong company. We pivoted last year And now we are in the Bay Area. Good chunk of that money will go towards R&D. We need to file, you know, do product development, file patents. One of the things I didn't mention is that we operate on FDA approved devices, but eventually if we add more indicators, we will need to go through FDA approval. The other thing that we're looking at is to hire at least a part-time regulatory affairs officer. We need some support people. We have some prospect that will need support and a little bit in operation.
Awesome. Do we have questions from the audience? Does anyone want to? Oh, Dylan says, I just wanted to say that you've answered all of my questions as I prepared to type them. So excellent job on that. So I'm curious. So you have this on, so Carl has one, but I'll just finish my thought here. So you have this on right now. So when you're wearing this at home, what do you find yourself using it for most often?
So what I like to look at, I think I briefly mentioned, I like to really understand. So I am not, I don't have, I'm not hypertensive. Actually, my pressure tend to be lower than normal. However, I see a lot of variability in the data that I capture. So I quantify that variability as an indicator of my health status of the day. The other thing I'm really curious about is what's happening to me during night. I have to say, I come, in my previous life, I did develop sleep architecture solutions. So we understand sleep quite well. And there is a one-to-one correlation between sleep and vascular health. So if I have a bad, if I don't sleep well, I can see that my blood pressure goes up dramatically at night. And at night I'm at rest. Why is that? Because especially in the early hours of the morning when we are awake, the cortisol level rises, and that gives rise to blood pressure. So if I'm agitated, my cortisol is a stress hormone higher. And so I keep an eye on that. I try to do, some lifestyle modification. If I have a couple of bad days, I'm like, okay, that's it. I'm going to the gym. I'm changing. I'm not eating that late. So for me, it's mostly lifestyle modification because I'm overall healthy. Although I am the only one in my family who doesn't have a cardiovascular issue. So I'm kind of on the watch for that.
Thanks. Carl, do you want to unmute and ask your question?
CD asked a question that's maybe better handled first, which is, I kind of missed missed the status of the sensor. CD asked right after me, are the sensors ready? So I think we should address that first and then come back to my question.
Yeah.
So what's the status, time to market for your different stages, and when do you expect to go to the FDA, things like that?
Okay, so today, this is on the market. This has the optical sensors here. We can sell these today. Actually, we have, I mentioned we have a number of prospects. We have been selling these for a little while. The sensor patch is not on the market yet. We have a prototype, an alpha, if you will. We are doing essentially development on the prototype. If you saw the slide that looks like a sandwich, there are many different components. Today with that, we can, we can measure blood pressure, but it's still in alpha stage. We are hoping to get to deliver an MVP by the end of the year, beginning of next year. And I'm sorry, what was the last question?
So in terms of blood pressure, continuous cuffless blood pressure, that's a crowded space. There's a lot of companies working on it. Several already have either EU approval or FDA approval and are actually selling devices in the market now. So why will you win over these others that are a little bit ahead of you?
Okay, so I believe, yes, there is, if I can say it this way, there is a big buzz in the market. I just want to make sure that we differentiate between the vendors that say continuous blood pressure, which means you can wear a device and push a button that measure blood pressure, once an hour, once every 15 minutes, whenever you want to do it. We don't require any initiation. We measure continuously, all the time, 24/7. That's
So there's at least three companies on the market already, BioBeat, Actia, and Live Metric, that already have non-button pushing continuous blood pressure.
Yeah.
Actia is still in FDA approval in the US, but it's got EU approval. BioBeat and Live Metric are already approved in the US, not selling direct to consumer, but selling to clinics and doctors.
Yeah. So those are companies that are on our radar. With Actia, our approach is different. I don't know if you have followed the details of how they measure. One of the challenges of measuring continuous blood pressure is that you need to be able to do it on all conditions, including when people take hypertensive drugs. And the way they do it, they're not capable of measuring under certain conditions. There was actually a paper that was published. On the FDA approval, today we do not have that problem because effectively we operate on FDA approved devices. Tomorrow we will have to, as we change the form factor, we'll have to go through FDA approval.
Okay, thank you very much, Silvia. Really enjoyed your presentation. We're going to move on to our next presenter, Jáchym.
Okay, let me share my screen. Right. Can you see my screen and hear me? Yeah. Okay, so I'm Jáchym Fibír. I'm the CEO of April 19 Discovery. And we are an AI-driven drug discovery platform. And we want to take psychedelic therapies out of mental health into other indications, and starting with dementia. So we see dementia as one of the biggest issues that the aging population, that is rapidly aging at this point, and it's because incidence of dementia beyond 60 years increases exponentially. And so there will not be enough caretakers and facilities to manage that increase in patients. And also it will prevent us to actually live healthy with a clear and full cognitive abilities beyond a certain age. And so psychedelics could be potential treatments here. So after they've been validated in mental health, new research now shows that through their complex mechanism of action, they could also be neurodegenerative indications and brain injuries. And that's because triple action. So they increase neuroplasticity, reduce neuroinflammation, and some of them also have acute neuroprotective effects. And the case in point here is pretty much an amazing case study. It's an unofficial case study. We reported on that on Spanner. And it was that when a certain psychedelic, a natural one in nasal spray, 4 months of daily treatment has improved a patient's cognitive ability so much that from an advanced case of Alzheimer's dementia, essentially became a normally functioning person, and they formally retracted his diagnosis. And so there's some limitations to that. It is a bit of an intense treatment, and there might be, you know, limitations for long-term outpatient use. And I'm happy to share more about that. But what we want to do is efficacy.
Sorry. 1 second. And could everyone just mute? Because we've got a lot of background noise. Thank you.
All right. So what we want to do is to design and develop better versions that will be optimized for long-term neurological treatments, even for advanced cases. And they would be active in doses that are not intoxicating, not limiting the functionality of that person, are ideally orally once a day, and without the associated cardiotoxicity risk or tolerance buildup associated with natural psychedelics, and also looking at novel patentable NCEs. So our team, it's myself, I'm a medicinal chemist and drug designer who has been focusing on psychedelic research the entire career. And the two original co-founders are Saran and Richard. So those are both long-term experts with over two decades of experience in applying AI in different fields. And newly, we have additional members. One of them is Gabriel, the software developer from Czechia, who is going to be in charge of the continued platform development into a standalone software. And Noga, who is a neuroimmunologist from Stanford, will be overseeing the preclinical and clinical development. And so I've split kind of the presentation of what we're doing in three parts. First is the research and unique hypothesis we're working from. Second is the AI platform and software that we've built. And third is the actual strategy with our partners going forward and how that works. So the research I've been doing at University of Chemistry and Technology in Prague identified that there is a unique off-target activity for certain 5-HT2A agonists who are, classical psychedelics. And I've been trying to design and synthesize compounds with the secondary activity stronger. And we already own the IP rights by a negotiation with the university to the compound synthesized, and want to have a sponsored research agreement with them for future compounds that we'll be working on. And basically, the core of the hypothesis that we have, and it's more complex, but I'll try to just get the core idea, is that 5-HT2A with classical psychedelics, as they activate it, causes certain undesirable effects. And by introducing secondary activity that also produce neuroplasticity and have some complementary ways how it works with 5-HT2A, we could increase neuroplasticity more robustly, and there could be higher ratio of neuroplastic effects to the hallucinogenic one associated with 5-HT2A. Also, lower tolerance buildup, that's also 5-HT2A mediated, and 5-HT2B mediated is the risk of cardiotoxicity that will also be reduced. Additionally, the second target provides acute neuroprotective effects. And What we've built so far is the software that includes a suite of different models and computational tools. So starting with generative AI for generating compounds with certain properties, evolving them to improve their properties, then have a suite of activity prediction from affinity to drug-likeness to toxicity, even selectivity at multiple receptors. And there's a lot of other tools I can't describe all right now, but we have that platform and software connected to services by different partners, both commercial and academic, and really looking at as effective and fast approach to drug discovery and development as we can. And so just to highlight one of the newest partners that we're entering into a research collaboration with is King's College London, where we want to do high throughput of immunofluorescent imaging of iPSC neurons or neuroplasticity. And so the business model, the primary revenue stream, if you will, is going to be using the patent portfolio based on our data that we generate to form co-development partnerships. And we're looking at big pharma companies, psychedelic companies, and neurodegeneration or neurology companies. And also want to keep some of our projects in-house. So we have some project in-house and some of them in co-development or joint ventures. And so the market, if we consider that for the natural occurring psychedelics, we are looking at over 40 indications where they are being investigated in, and we doing essentially safer versions available for even long-term treatment in an outpatient setting, but also even increase the potential amount of indications we can target, and we will have the platform to match and optimize compounds that are most suitable for the requirements of patients in each indication that we're going to pursue. And we want to start in the immediate future with clinical trials and strategically selected neurodegenerative indications that was going to be the most advantageous in terms of clinical trial design. And ideally looking at confirmation in phase two clinical trials in about 5 years. And then going forward, we want to serve as a platform for different kinds of indications, different kinds of projects, some in-house, some externally. And if we get to the point where aging is recognized as a disease, we will be in a great position to actually serve the huge patient base that is going to be there, over 2 billion people aged 60 plus and between 2040 and 2050. And so we want to get a good shot, we'll have a good shot of getting some portion of that market. And so currently we're raising $2 million seed. So what we want to do with that money is primarily generate a lot of preclinical data and with several projects that we'll be running, both in collaboration with UCT Prague and others generated through our platform and other partners, and getting some advanced safety and efficacy data for some of them to be looking to file an IND, and obviously have an IP protection of the most promising chemotypes and uses for these compounds. Also, we want to have this platform software improved with the AI models kind of trained on the data that we generate. And so we've raised 460K pre-seed and also generated 600,000 revenues while doing services for another biotech company, kind of bootstrapping the development of the platform. And now we want to raise in essentially three steps. And first right now is the special vehicle for friends and angels and small investors, which is the greatest discount. Then we also want to offer a discount for the early committing VCs with some larger checks. And then according to the demand, we will have the main full round after that. And that's all for now. I cut out some slides that I can go into some topics where you have questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Do we have any questions from the audience? If not, I can kind of jump in. I have a question. So you showed like a case study of one gentleman who recovered. Is there any data about psychedelics and neurodegeneration that has a bigger in?
So currently there's only one ongoing clinical trial looking at psilocybin for mild cognitive impairment in early Alzheimer's dementia. But the primary purpose of that trial is to look at how that helps the depression associated with these conditions, and only secondary looking whether it can improve the actual cognition and progress of the disease. So there are only anecdotal cases like this. There are some others that are not as well described as this one, because here we have the cognitive test being done at the time of a diagnosis where the person was positive for a tau protein. So it's a valid diagnosis of Alzheimer's. And there are also some brain imaging data that have been generated sometime prior to the diagnosis and then now, which is a year and a half after the diagnosis, I think. But I haven't had a look at the data. It's not public, but I've spoken to the person who has administered the medicine here. It's Adam Depp. And I've also spoken to him on a podcast about that, where he shares a little bit more information. But otherwise, no, in human trials, there's not many, evidence, but there's a lot of preclinical and basic research evidence for, how psychedelics could affect neurodegeneration and restoring the brain functionality through neuroplasticity and reducing chronic inflammation.
So the follow-up then is, can you elaborate on that preclinical, or did you go over that in detail already? Like, there's higher end in preclinical models, even though we hate mouse models of dementia.
Yeah. So first of all, here are the three pillars of the activity. I would say first is the effect on neuroplasticity, where there's this idea that as the brain ages and loses neurons, even in natural state, the cognitive function is regained or preserved by surviving neurons making additional connections.
These are more method of action stuff, right? Is there an actual mouse study with an Alzheimer's, with a preclinical model?
Currently ongoing are, so they have been looking at mice and how that neuroplasticity markers are essentially improved. Our advisor in Poland, Ursula Kozlowska, is now performing, she's doing both in vitro study with microglia, looking at markers of chronic inflammation and as a model of Alzheimer. She also has a mouse model of AD, essentially using the classical amyloid beta model of mice and seeing how psilocybin can affect that. But I personally believe that psilocybin is not ideal for Alzheimer's because of it does not activate the second target that we are pursuing, and also has a tolerance buildup, so it cannot be dosed every day or otherwise it loses the therapeutic effect. So I think it's misleading to look at the preclinical experiments that are like one dose and seeing this effect, because for a real effect in humans, you would need to do a long-term treatment, and then you need to look at psychedelics that don't have such a tolerance buildup, such as 5-MeO-DMT has been used in the nasal spray.
We have a question in the chat.
Sorry. Okay.
Yeah. Salah, and then we'll take the question in the chat. Yes. So Supa will be okay.
Sorry. Very, very exciting. I'm curious. So you mentioned the psychedelics they have these effects, but you're going to optimize for their, well, reduce their toxicity or their cardiotoxicity. That was correct, right? So, and if that's the case, so for the platform, you're optimizing for toxicity, and is this combined with in vitro studies, or how does that work? Because these mechanisms of action, like, I'm just curious, like, how are you building this model to optimize for all of this or just one of them? And how does that go hand in hand with the experimental mm-hmm. work?
So essentially, there's steps. First step is the core, designing compounds that not only bind to 5-HT2A, the primary psychedelic target, but also the second target. Currently, we're not sharing what the target is, but the natural psychedelics have only very weak affinity to that secondary target. We want to increase that so it's more equipotent. Both of these effects could be felt, and that in itself reduces some of the toxicity or issues associated with selective 5-HT2 agonists or classical psychedelics.
Oh, I see.
And then further on, we would be looking to select the candidates that have the optimal properties, which is like oral bioavailability, checking for 5-HT2B affinity, whether by effect, it should be decreased or can be decreased if you introduce some part of the action from the secondary target. But obviously, those will be kind of secondary endpoints in the optimization process. But there's also a bit of a thing that we need to focus on, the tolerance buildup, which is essentially can be done through that's more complex because 5-HT2 has a functional selectivity activating different pathways with different ligands. So there's different functional assays that can be used, but essentially we know what causes tolerance buildup, it's beta arrestin recruitment pathway. And it can be actually by optimization in the design reduced so they don't produce such tolerance. And there's other things, but there's kind of the gist of our hypothesis that we think we know what are the perfect properties to optimize for. Obviously, we will be doing both receptor studies as on affinity, functional assays, as I mentioned, and then the neuroplasticity phenotypic screening, which we'll be doing also in a high throughput regime and high content imaging of different parameters and using our AI to browse through that, select the most optimal generation of neuroplasticity, even in repeated dosage. And then obviously, then we'll be going to some of the neuroimmunology assays and models of Alzheimer's. We're not sure whether we're going to do AD models in mice because they might be worse. And actually, FDA does not require evidence of efficacy in animal models anymore for an IND, but only toxicity now. So if we can bypass mice, we will do that through in vitro assay.
Thank you.
So we only have 15 minutes left, so I am going to move on to the next presentation, but thanks so much. And if you guys have questions, feel free to jump in Longevity Global Slack and ask the presenter yourself. So we really encourage that. Awesome.
All right. Hello, everyone. Can you hear me? Okay, well, my name is Dave Sheska. I'm the founder and CSO of Eterna Biotechnology, and what we do is we target senescence with virus-like particles. If you want to connect, that's my information right there. So what's the problem? Problem, senescence. Senescence is an irreversible pro-inflammatory state of cell cycle arrest, so you can have many different things causing this, DNA damage people are familiar with, oxidative stress, free radicals. But one of the outcomes can be senescence. And the problem is an accumulation of senescent cells leads to human aging in general. One of the reasons why we think we age at all is the accumulation of senescent cells. So of course you have age-associated diseases like heart, lung, pelvic organ prolapse, diabetes, cancer, others. And so getting more into some clinical outcomes, senescence can lead to atherosclerotic plaques. So we have this healthy endothelium here. These cells are endothelial cells. They're on the inside of veins and arteries. And through the natural coursing of aging or metabolic stressors like a high-fat diet, also known as a Western diet, you can develop atherosclerosis. So there are senescent cells here. These are senescent endothelial cells, and they begin overexpressing these surface proteins. And you can target them, and you can have your immune system clear these cells eventually. And then what the overall outcome is a reduced aortic plaque. And so how can I claim that? Well, previous data from a standard vaccination platform illustrate aortic plaque and senescence clearance here. So they took control versus vaccine. Anything in red is an aortic plaque, and they show quantitatively a reduced aortic plaque area in their vaccine. So yes, it works. They took a look at fluorescent senescent cells, and they see a clear reduction in senescence as well. So it does work for both, but we do one better. We upgraded to a virus-like particle platform. And just to illustrate how it works really quick, it mimics viral structure with no viral genetic material. So what that means is it's non-infectious, which increases safety and reduces cost to produce. Fantastic. VLPs display repetitive surface proteins, so you can have a combinatorial therapy. We're undergoing conversations right now to try to combine therapies between RVLP and others, hopefully for a vaccine of the ages. But the benefits of VLPs is a continual revenue stream in the form of six-month boosters. Whenever you target self-antigen, these are very safe. So if you have a problem, stop. 6 months later, you'll be absolutely fine, but also the continual revenue stream. So there is excellent safety in early stage clinical trials with other VLPs targeting self. There's a high yield in bacterial cell culture, batch culture, really. So 1 liter can produce around 20,000 human doses. This is economies of scale. We can produce this. Well-established platform with 40 years of research behind it. It's compatible with current manufacturing processes, and there have been previously FDA-approved VLPs, so we don't have to reinvent the wheel here. What did we do? We started with a preclinical model. VLPs were administered intramuscularly, and outcomes were monitored. We used an 18-month-old, so this is around 65 in human terms, Black 6 mouse model. This is just the standard model that everybody uses. There's a 3-dose series once every 3 weeks, and then just to reiterate, humans would require a 6-month booster. Lifespan was performed. We monitored prolapse and cardiopulmonary protections. And the reason, main reason why I say we upgraded is because we showed that lifespan is significantly increased. Previous data showed that in females, it was not. We do. So you can see survival here at 100%, control dies off, therapy lives longer. This is significantly different. Our primary indication is actually pelvic organ prolapse. You might be worried that we should be targeting cardiovascular, but like Carl said, the market's relatively saturated right now. Drugs like PCSK9, they do a fantastic job of targeting cardiovascular diseases. Let's let them do their work. We'll do ours. So this would be a first-in-class prolapse vaccine prevention therapy with a market size of around 200 million female Americans. In the U.S., if you didn't know, around 1/3 of women are at risk of a pelvic organ prolapse event by the time they reach 50. And around 50% of women above 50 have experienced a prolapse event in their life. That is awful. We want to target this. And then we also know that senescence has been proposed as a pathophysiological driver of senescence. Now we have a mechanism. We're targeting senescence. We're seeing great protective effects in our therapy here. Our secondary indication, cardiovascular protection illustrated through ejection fraction. So ejection fraction is the fraction of blood that gets pumped out of your heart every time it beats. Reductions are known to be associated with age. And we can see that from the control versus the therapy, we do have a protective effect here. Our third indication could be pulmonary protection, and that's illustrated through breathing frequency and minute volume. So breaths per minute also declines with age, and just look at how clean these data are. We see a very, very good protective effect in our therapy here, and this is frequency, weeks post-vaccination. We also see minute volume normalized by weight, because that's what you have to do. We started off a little bit below control, and we ended up on top. Fantastic stuff here. So we do have protective effects in pulmonary as well. Current protection after senolytic vaccine and estimated max yearly revenues from each. So if we're talking about prolapse protection, this would not be a premier cost model. So we're talking about $21 billion. This is 5 years into the market. Cardiovascular protection, this would be a premier cost model. So this would be $37.5 billion. Again, with pulmonary premier cost, $22.5 billion. I do have the calculation slides if you want to follow up. Lifespan extension. If we ever had the FDA approved lifespan extension, then it would be worth around 150. What is our major ask? Our major ask is we're trying to do a LOX-L1 knockout mouse model because it does develop pelvic organ prolapse in 6 months after giving birth to pups. This recapitulates a lot of the symptoms that occur in humans because mice are not the best model, but otherwise we would have to go into non-human primates, and that would be about a $4 million study. We were going to establish the POP phenotype and then follow up every 2 months with assay monitoring. We're going to need around 30 animals for statistical significance. This will cost around $400,000 because we want to turn this into a lifespan as well, and we want to ask a contract research organization to perform it. There's two reasons for that. They are more expensive, but their data is reproducible. They are meticulous, and they can adhere to GLP. This will be in the spirit of GLP, but we can go back and do a GLP study down the line if need be, and they ensure accuracy. The second reason is because I'm kind of sick of the irreproducibility problem, and the startup cost for a lab would be kind of cost prohibitive at this point, so a CRO seems to be the way to go. So we're requesting $1.5 million in total with an exit time point of 3 years. That would be $400K for the preclinical data and then $350 per year in research and development for secondary and tertiary indications. We're going to retain internal key scientific staff. We need IP and legal protections, of course, and we need to start developing the medical affairs and regulatory development team now so that we can start those conversations with the FDA. This is our team right here. Matt Campen, he's got 30 years pharmaceutical research. Mark McCormick, he's an aging expert and knows so many people in the aging field. Bryce Jakarian, he's got 47 patents and he's a VLP researcher. And Kieran Bhaskar, he's an immunologist and aging expert with 30 years in experience. We know some of our unknowns. We are going to need a CEO who has taken a drug to clinic. And we do know that a lot of these numbers are optimistic, of course, but we do have the calculations to back that up. And I'm happy to talk with anybody who wants to ask.
Thank you so much. This is awesome. So I have a question. So why produce this as a vaccine as opposed to another type of gene therapy?
Oh, as far as like targeting senescence through a different mode?
Yeah.
Gotcha. So yeah, we do see CAR T cell therapy targeting senescent markers and CAR M cell therapy, things like that. But I mean, they're so expensive. And a lot of the times CAR T cell therapy can be dangerous too. I don't know of any CAR Ms that have gone to the clinic. I hope they have, because I'm really excited about that too. But ours is a lot cheaper to produce and it's shown to be very, very safe as well.
Do we have other questions from the audience here?
Yeah, exactly.
I did notice that. It was hard to Google the name.
Yep, we are still under development with the name. This is very new. We were actually very excited to see any of the outcomes that we saw. We didn't expect it to be so different from the original. So this is basically patented, produced in the past 6 months.
So why don't you be the CEO? That's my question.
Yeah, I do have the MBA behind my back, but I have more limited business experience. I'm peripherally around a lot of business people, but I have not led a company, and I would hate to have this potential therapy fail just because of my lack of experience. I mean, I have all of the book knowledge to take a drug to clinical trials. I know the steps that you're going to need to get there, but I have not had those specific conversations with FDA. You know, I've never had those specific conversations with the people behind the scenes that they don't write in a book. And so I don't want to screw anything up.
All right. Last chance to jump in with a question here. Otherwise, we're going to wrap up. Okay. Thank you very much. Really appreciate everyone participating in this first Longevity Global community pitch. So thanks a lot. And feel free to follow up with any of our presenters about any further questions. And we'll see you next time. Have a great day.